You know, sometimes we don't realize how favored we are. But favor is earned, isn't it? Because trust is earned. When you earn God's trust, he releases more to you. Amen? And it's just the little things. You know, the word says that when you do his will, he releases a promise. So sometimes his will, it just says, go speak to this person. Amen. Most of the time, it's training. So when God says, I want you to do this to learn something, then he releases something in response to what you've been obedient to. But if you don't do it, then the enemy opens up and the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Amen. And we go back in that cycle again. Or there's something that, you know, people don't realize that the enemy then put limitations. It's only so much you can grow. But in the Spirit of God, you can grow, and grow. But the enemy will try to place limitations on our life and everything that we do. And it happens by touching and agreeing with unclean things. Touching and agreeing with the voice of the stranger. Touching and agreeing with worldliness. Touching and agreeing with sin. Touching and agreeing with certain things. Approving of those things. Saying it's okay. I'm telling you right now, one of the things that the Lord has really put on my heart, and we've talked about some of this before, and it's usually expressed in almost everything, is holy. Everyone say holy.
Holy.
See, holy can only be backed by Holy Spirit. Why? Because he's the one that convicts. He convicts. If you reject his conviction, then you reject becoming holy. Now, holy isn't anything that you and I can accomplish in ourselves. It's from him. When holy comes by the presence of the Holy Spirit, called divine nature. Amen? So in this, we try to do works to please God, but many times we stumble because the area we do it in our own strength instead of yielding to the Holy Spirit. But I'm telling you, when God tells you to do something, he gives you the power to do it. It's when man says, do this, you walk in your own strength. So there's an area right now where there's such a shift and such a move and so many things that are occurring right now, and it's going through the body of Christ in every area. We're seeing more boldness. And God is releasing holy boldness. Everyone say holy boldness.
Holy boldness.
And in this holy boldness, God is saying, look, it's a spiritual boldness. It's what we call a righteous boldness. And in this, we don't take no garbage.
Amen.
Don't take no garbage from no devil.
Amen.
You know, and don't take no garbage from no human that's got devils.
Amen.
You stand for the truth.
Amen.
Amen. That was the problem with religious spirits. See, religious spirits is a demon. In a person that can quote scripture but can't yield to the Spirit of God.
Amen.
Does everybody understand that?
Right.
And that religious spirit is the worst spirit that Jesus dealt with the whole time he was here. He was always, I mean, they were always trying to trick him. They had a club called Sanhedrin.
Amen.
Many of them were bound by religious spirits. That's all they tried to do. It's challenged Jesus. And they challenged Jesus in every area of what truth was. What doctrine was. See, they knew doctrine. Jesus wasn't coming with a new doctrine. He was coming with what was already spoken, but manifesting it and setting up a whole new covenant for his children. Because what was in the Old Testament, he said, I'm going to bring in you now. But they rejected it. And many people are still rejecting. They reject it. They call themselves Christians, but they still reject. And so they're really not walking in holy boldness, because only holy boldness can be backed by Holy Spirit. And that means there must be a connection all the time in the Spirit. You're connected to the Holy Spirit. You're looking for conviction. Does everybody understand that? You look to be convicted. Why? Because you want to be right with God. You don't want anything in between you and him. Why? He's your dad, you're his child. If you love him, you don't want anything to get in between. When he says something, you know it's for your good. You don't justify and argue and whatever. You know it's for your good if you can accept his love. But I can tell you right now, there's an area where people are just expressing. There's just so much expression of God's love and not reality of God's judgment. Amen? So, and whatever you sow, you do what? You reap. Nobody gets away with it. You sow righteousness, you reap righteousness. You sow mercy, you reap mercy. You sow respect, you get respect. A lot of people want respect and ain't sowed a stinking piece of respect at all. Not even a seed of it. They just do whatever they want. And you will never get respect. Amen? Respect comes in an area, that's where the word says, submit to God, resist the devil. If you can't respect God, you're not going to respect man. And in this, God is saying, look, it's time. We talked about, and we talked about many things. Hallelujah. But I knew it a time to act. There's a call to act. Amen? God is calling his children to begin to act. And in this area of act, he's calling me and you to be bold. I mean, bolder than we've ever been. Bold. Bold. Everyone say bold.
Bold.
Turn to your neighbor and say, be bold.
Be bold.
Get bold. And stand in bold. Holy boldness. Glory to God. You know, when there's holy boldness, there's holy shift. Because when you say something, man, there's a shift that happens right afterwards. 2 Peter chapter 3. Glory. 2 Peter chapter 3. Glory. Hallelujah. 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 1. Is everybody there? Let's speak it together, please. Beloved, I now write to you this second epistle, in both of which I stir up your what? Your pure minds. Your pure minds, right? Okay. That's good. Stir up your pure minds. Everyone say pure mind. Not carnal mind, pure mind. Stir up your pure minds by way of reminder, that you may be mindful of the words which were spoken before by the holy prophets in the commandments of us, the apostles of the Lord and Savior. Knowing this first, scoffers. Everyone say scoffer. Those are scorners, mockers, and so forth. Scoffers will come in the last days. I mean, come on, you're seeing more scoffers than you've ever seen. Walking according to their own what? Lust. Walking according to their own lust. Walk according to their own will. Walking according to their own way. Having no respect to God. And saying, where is the promise of his coming? Well, believe me, if he came then, those people would be lost. For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation. For this they willfully forget that by the word of God the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of water and in the water, by which the world that then existed perished, being flooded with water. What was God doing? At that time, he actually, I want to say, slam dunked the earth. He flooded it completely to remove sin. That's amazing, isn't it? Think about it. God flooded the earth. It was like took the earth and put it underwater and drowned all sin so that it could come back up again and start anew. Now, he will do it again. Only this time, it's not even going to be with water, but it'll be with fire. It is coming. That's why the word says that Noah in the latter days will be the days of Noah. The days of Noah and the days of Sodom and Gomorrah. That's fire and water, isn't it? Amen. Verse 7. But the heavens and the earth, which are now preserved by the same word, are preserved for what? Fire, until a day of judgment and perdition of ungodly men. But beloved, I do not want you to forget this one thing, that with the Lord, one day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. The Lord is not slack concerning his promises, if some count slackness, but is long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all shall come to what? Repentance. Everyone say repentance. Repentance is not an area where you just say, Lord, forgive me. I'm sorry. It's an area where you not only take that, but you are serious enough to turn from what you've done that's offending him. Amen? That is true repentance. But he says that there are scoffers in the last days, those that are scorning and bitter. Many people have removed themselves because they've accepted the voice of the stranger and exchanged the love of God for bitterness. They use because of some kind of offense. You know, again, the world hates to be corrected, but you should welcome correction. As Christians, as children of the Most High God, we should not only welcome conviction, but we should welcome correction. Why? Because correction brings to direction, and conviction will rescue. Conviction is a warning. When God convicts you, he's warning you. Does everybody understand that? And when he warns you, if you reject that, he chastens you. There's a chastening. And why? He's trying to rescue me and you from judgment and from wrath. Amen. Wrath. Now, I want to share something very quick before I even go to the next scripture. My wife and I were listening to a gentleman's testimony. And this guy had died. All right? And he was taken. He went through the tunnel, the eternal port. And he ended up in a football field. I'm shortening it. All right, come on up here. She's going to tell you the testimony of this guy.
Hallelujah. So when he died, he went through the port. And the first thing that happened is that he got before the Lord, not in a football field.
Oh, what Sunday.
And immediately the Lord said to him, my church does not really believe that I am coming back soon. And he repeated it 3 or 4 times, each time with more conviction and more volume. My church does not really believe that I am coming back soon. So he was brought back to life. Well, this guy was.
And he said that they weren't, because they're not living coming back soon. The way they're living is not according to, like, I'm coming soon. They're ignoring it.
Right.
They're being ignorant of it.
If they believed I were coming back soon, they wouldn't be living the way they're living.
Yeah.
So he went on about the healing process. He actually died again. He was having huge respiratory issues. Now, this guy's a kind of a young guy. He's a cop. And he doesn't remember anything that happened the second time he died. But after that, he was going through the healing process and went to a therapy home, convalescing. And he was looking out the window, contemplating this vision of the Lord. And he found himself, whether in the body, out of the body, I don't know. He was taken, and he found himself in the middle of a football field. Not a cornfield, football field. And he's looking around, trying to figure out what he's doing in the middle of this football field. And he looked up, and he saw the scoreboard. And the scoreboard said 2:13. And God told him that it's a 2-minute warning. The whistle's about to blow. So he's contemplating all of this, and two women showed up at his door and said, we're your therapist. I'm the speech therapist. I'm the occupational therapist. And can we ask you a personal question? He said, sure. Are you a man of faith? He said, well, I haven't always been walking it right, but I am a Christian, and I've given my life to Jesus Christ. And they said, well, We were walking by this door the other day, and the one woman had a vision of a huge number two. And she said, "Lord, what is that?" There was this number two outside his door. And he told her, "You go ask that man what the number two is and see if he has an answer for you." So they did. And the man said to her, he said, "That's kind of an odd question. Why are you asking me this?" So she explained about this whole number two thing. And he said, "It's a two-minute warning." And then he began to ask the Lord about, you know, that was confirmation for him, right, that these two women came. He was asking the Lord what the 2:13 was, and it was Titus. It was
yes.
Titus 2:13. You might as well go there. So when he asked why the 13 for the two-minute warning, he gave him Titus 2:13. And it says, everybody read it together. Titus 2:13. Ready?
Hold on, not everybody's there. Huh?
Okay, let's go. Looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Wow. Powerful. And that was the vision that where this man had come to, and he's saying, "Look at," and everybody knows anything about sports that there's always a, in other words, a 2-minute warning or some kind of a warning. Say this is so you got to do whatever you can to win the game, amen. And God is saying we are entering, or have entered the 2-minute warning. So stop living like he's not coming and start living like he may show up any minute. Amen? Turn to the book of Jude. Glory. Jude. God is good all the time. Jude, verse 12. I think. Jude 12. I think that's it. Hallelujah. Is everybody there?
Amen.
These are spots in your love feast while they feast with you without fear, serving only the who?
Themselves.
They are clouds without water, carried about by the winds, late autumn trees without fruit, twice dead, pulled up by the roots, raging waves of sea foaming up in their own shame, wandering stars for whom there is reserved the blackness of darkness forever. Now Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied about these men, also saying, "Behold, the Lord comes with 10,000s of his saints." To what? Execute. To say what? Execute. That's boldness, ain't it? On all, to convict all who are ungodly among them of their ungodly deeds, which they have committed in an ungodly way, and all the harsh things which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. These are grumblers and complainers, walking according to their own lusts. And they mouth great swelling words, flattering people to gain advantage. But you, beloved, remember the words which were spoken before by the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ, how they told you that there would be what? Mockers, scorners. Does everybody get it? In the last time, who would walk according to their own ungodly lust. In other words, their will, their way, and their desires. These are sensual people who cause divisions. Why? Because they can't be submissive. Not having the Spirit. Not connected to the Spirit of the living God. Not connected to the Holy Spirit. They cause divisions because they're not connected. And that's what the enemy always wants to do, is disconnect us in every area. But you, beloved, building yourselves up on the most holy faith, praying in tongues in the Holy Spirit, Keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercies of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. And on some have what? Compassion, making a distinction, but on others save with what? Fear. You're going to hell, bonehead, if you don't do something. Amen. Pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment defiled by the flesh, making fear. Why? Some people just got to, you know, fear. I mean, because they won't get it any other way. They won't get it any other way. And in this, people are not really realizing, and many believers have fallen into this play, this deception that, oh, things are just going to be hunky-dory. Everything's going to be fine. I can just go on with my life and do what I need to do and whatever. And God knows my heart. But he's saying, listen, you're not living in, under that two-minute warning now. We must be living under the two-minute warning. Quit planning your future. We don't have one. Has everybody got it? We don't have a future. Our future is there.
Amen.
And let him build a house. See, if you're trying to plan your future, then you're not living in it. You live from the future to the present. That's why you allow him to plan it, not us. Oh, these are things I'm going to do. Oh, really? The word says you're not promised tomorrow. Does everybody understand that? If you've really given your life to the Lord, then let him have it.
Amen.
And let him plan it. Let him establish it. Let him position you. Let him perfect it. Let him bring you through the trials and tribulations so that you can take off you and put on more of him. Remember, Jesus looks for Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah. Matthew 24. Matthew 24, holy boldness. You know, the word said something. Again, you know, I could go on and on in the area where it talks about the 10 virgins, those that are wise and those are foolish. There are, believe me, many foolish virgins are out there. You can't overcome sin without the anointing. You can't overcome sin without the presence of God. You're not going to do it. I don't care how much word you have. I don't care if you can memorize the Bible. You can't do it without God's presence. It's impossible. And let me tell you what happens then. When you begin to do what you want to do and your desires are becoming manifest, the presence of God will step aside. And a familiar spirit will come. And you think it's the Holy Spirit. But yet you're walking further and further away from God's will. And then what happens? Something is stolen. Something is destroyed. Something is happening. Your identity begins to drift. Who you are. Things begin to happen. And in that, because we have rejected conviction, counsel, correction, no longer being led by the Spirit of God, but being misled by a familiar spirit. Remember, the devil is out to steal, kill, and destroy in every area. Anything that you give him an opportunity to, he will take. He will take. In Matthew 24, verse 4. So we want to be wise virgins. Now, as a wise virgin, you worship. As a wise virgin, you need to have the oil of God. You know, when we were praying in the Spirit, the Holy Spirit showed me something today. I thought it was pretty nifty. After we were getting filled with the Holy Spirit, getting filled with oil, and he said, ignite it. And when he said, praying in tongues is like putting two rocks together and going, sparking it. So when you're praying in tongues, what you're actually doing is setting the sparks to ignite the oil. Then all of a sudden you flow and the tongues flow. But in the beginning, sometimes it's, you know, it's like kickstarting a Harley or something. You got to bum, bum, bum. You got to bust through until the oil gets ignited. And the next thing you know, you're flowing. So that's why it's so important to pray in tongues every day, every morning. And God will give you the gift if you don't have it yet. In fact, if you ask for it, you already have it. Now you just got to walk in the manifestation of it. Amen? Oh, glory. In verse 4, would you speak it with me, please? And Jesus answered and said to them, "Take heed that no one deceives you, for many will come in my name, saying, 'I am the Christ,' and will what?
Deceive
many. And you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and these will be, and there will be what? Famines, pestilence, earthquakes in various places. All these are called the beginning of sorrows." And I really believe that the beginning of the sorrows is associated with breaking seals. Then you have other things that follow. You have the trumpets, and then you have the bowls, or what we call vials. He said, "Then they will deliver you up to tribulation, and they will kill you or attempt to kill you, for you will be hated." Everyone said, "I'll be hated." Do you know that the devil hates you?
Amen.
Do you know how much persecution is going on and how many Christians are being slaughtered? Jews and Christians are being slaughtered all over the world. In fact, they're being persecuted greatly in this country right now by our own government, who is Antichrist. Or they wouldn't be promoting same-sex marriage or having the rainbow on the White House before it was even approved. They just turned the lights on because they knew it was going to get approved. They wouldn't be promoting abortion. It's like putting your children through the fire. They wouldn't be taking the Word of God out, the Ten Commandments, prayer, God out of the Pledge of Allegiance. They wouldn't be doing those things if they were not Antichrist. And if the body would start getting bolder and standing up for what is right and rebuking these idiots, we might become more unified. See, they hate me and you. They don't really hate you personally. They hate what's in you. And they don't even know why they hate you. Because the demons in them hate you. It says that they will deliver you up to tribulation and will kill you, attempt to kill you, and they're going to hate you. And you'll be hated by all nations for my name's sake. Why? Because they see the seal of Christ on you. But if you got one foot in the world and one foot in the kingdom, the seal is very diminished. In fact, I doubt it's even there. Because you cannot serve two masters. The devil have his way on you if you're serving two masters. It says in verse 10, the many will be what? Offended. Offended. See, offense will be one of the sure signs in that arena, because people are rejecting conviction, counsel, and correction, and exchange it for offense. Offense. That means that there's still something touching. They're serving two masters. Does everybody understand that? Where there's offense, there's self-promotion. There's self-protection. Amen? Offense is always a fruit of the old man. Always. Then many will be offended and will be what? And will do what? They're going to betray one another and will hate one another. Betrayal is a really big thing right now. We talked about the spirit of Judas. Then many false prophets will rise up and deceive many, and because of what? Lawlessness will abound, and the love of many will do what? It will grow cold. People will come out of on fire for God and walk into a lukewarm. And in that lukewarmness, their actually love will become colder and colder. But it says, he who endures to the end will be what? saved. And this gospel of the kingdom of God will be preached in all the world as a witness to all nations, and then the end will come. So love is going to grow cold, and you will be hated. And it is happening right now. And lawlessness is increasing more. And approval of lawlessness is increasing more and more. In Ephesians 4. Is everybody there? Let's speak it. Ephesians 4, verse 17. This I say, therefore, and testify in the Lord, that you should no longer walk as the rest of the Gentiles walk, in the futility of their mind, having their understanding what? Darkened. In other words, they don't understand. They don't realize that there's a two-minute warning. They don't realize what's happening. They don't even realize what's influencing them. They just live their life according to way. No identity of the unseen. Don't even believe in devils, most of them. Having their understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God. The life of God that is an upright, righteous, living life. Desiring not to sin, desiring to please God, hating evil, and willing to expose sin. Living a life of God. That means you're right with Him. You're connected. Living a life of God says, I live to please you, not myself. Because of the ignorance that is in them, because of the blindness of their heart, who being past feeling have given themselves over to lewdness, to work all uncleanness with what? Greediness. He says, you've not learned Christ. You've not learned the anointing. You've come to the services. You've come to Bible studies. You've done all these things, but you've really not believed, received, and executed. So you're not practicing it. If indeed you have heard Him and have been taught by Him, as the truth is in Jesus, that you would do what then? You'd put off. You'd put off the old man. You'd expose your own garbage before somebody else does. You would consider your intents, your motives, and your desires. You'd watch what's coming out of your mouth. You would sense how you feel towards someone. And if you know that it wasn't right, you would make the change in front of God. Does everybody understand? You would make that change. You would be forgiving. You wouldn't allow bitterness or offense to take hold of you or grip you. Your mouth would speak good things. Who being past feeling have given themselves over to what? Verse 19, lewdness, to work all uncleanness with greediness, but you've not so learned Christ. If indeed you heard Him and have been taught by Him, as the truth is in Jesus, that you do what again? Put off concerning your old man, the way you used to live in the world. The grumbling, the complaining, the criticizing, all the other garbage. That you would put off that type of life, because that is not a life of God. That is a life of the devil. The old man which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind. So you are now discerning. You are now checking who told me that. Now you're becoming more sensitive to the unseen. You know, when it says become the life of God, well, Jesus is the example of the life of God. That's a godly life. And the example that He's given us is He always, always looked to the unseen. He was always able to see through a person. He knew what their motives were and their intents were and their thoughts were, didn't He? Amen. He always knew. And you and I must know, but first we got to search our own. And that you put on the what? The new man, which was created according to God in true what? Righteousness and holiness. Everyone say righteousness, righteousness and holiness. Therefore, put away what? Lying. Let each one of you speak truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. And now here's something powerful. Because this is holy boldness. Be angry, but don't sin. Amen. That's holy boldness. Be angry and don't sin. Why? Because you hate evil. And if you're going to pet evil and compromise evil, then you are serving two masters. And evil will overtake you again. Has everybody got it? Be angry and don't sin, and do not let the sun go down on your wrath, nor give what? Nor give what? Place to the devil. It's amazing in how many times people give place to the devil. In the simplest thing, see, a little leaven leavens a whole lump. Let him who stole steal no longer, but rather let him labor, working with his hands what is good, that he may have something to give him who has need. And let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearers. Again, be angry, but don't sin. This is called holy anger. It's or righteous anger. It's also called holy boldness. Ephesians chapter 6. You know, there was an individual that was a part of the house of God and was doing some really stupid stuff. And then showed up to try to do more stupid stuff. And I went up to the person and I said, you know what? He said, what? I said, you're an idiot. And you know what he said to me? I know it. Because he knew what he was doing was wrong. But he still chose to do it. That's what you really call a moron. Not an idiot. And he said, I know it. I'm thinking, well, man, how stupid can you be and still breathe? Turn around. Turn the other way and do what's right. God desires no one to perish. He's trying to get something to us. Amen? In everything. He's trying to bless us. He's trying to prosper us. He's trying to bring us to that place. But we allow interruptions in a relationship with the Lord. In Ephesians 6:10, and I was very angry. But I didn't sin. But I had boldness. So I went right up to his face and said, you're an idiot. Anyways. Verse 10, finally, my brethren, be what? Strong in the Lord. You think that may be boldness? Amen. Amen. Be strong. Be bold. Be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the trickery. It's amazing. People still don't get to put on the full armor of God. They just get up, they eat, and they go, thank you, Lord, for another day. Let's see. You know what I need. You know my heart. Let's go. There's no connection. You don't make connection, you're on your own. You're not going to be able to hear or see or receive. Especially, you will not receive correction or conviction. You can't. Without connection, you can't receive. What usually happens is a person will stumble, something will occur in their life where they go, oh my God, what did I do? Now they're willing to receive. But many times it's too late and damage has been done. Amen? Be strong. Be bold. That's holy boldness. It is righteous anger. You are backed by the authority of Jesus Christ, the eternal kingdom, the Holy Spirit. Amen? Holy Spirit. And what is this boldness? You know, in this, what we are called to do in this boldness, because it's a boldness for righteousness. It's not a boldness for selfishness. What we're doing here is we're forcing evil to be exposed and removed. Everyone say, I'm forcing.
Forcing.
I'm enforcing. Evil to be exposed and removed. Without that, then you're not walking in boldness. Then the enemy looks at us as wimps. See, these powers of darkness know whether you are strong in the Lord or strong in yourself. They will challenge you with temptation. And if you bite the bait in a little, they'll come back with another one. And they try and increase it and increase it, increase it, to where you just break covenant unless you come to your senses. Amen? And Acts 4. Acts chapter 4. In verse 8. What does it say? Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit. Everyone say, filled with the Holy Spirit. Said to them, rulers of the people and the elders of Israel, if we this day are judged for a good deed done to a helpless man, by what means he has been made well, let it be known to you all and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him this man stands here before you whole. In other words, they prayed for a man and he was healed. This is the stone which was rejected by you builders, which has become the chief cornerstone. Nor is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. Now, when they saw the what? Boldness. The boldness of Peter and John, and perceived that they were uneducated and untrained men, they marveled, and they realized that they had been with Jesus. See, they realized they were connected. Do you understand that when you stand for boldness, the world is going to know that person's connected to God? Why? Because he don't laugh at those jokes no more. He doesn't look at those things that are defiling. He keeps himself unspotted from the world. Doesn't allow idols to dictate. It's quick to forgive and bless. Willing to walk away, not approving those things that others approve of that is defiling or offensive to the Lord. Does everybody get this? But it starts off being filled. Here he is preaching salvation, healing. God is doing all kinds of things. Let me tell you, the enemy will challenge you. He will challenge you. The enemy comes and threatens too. Do you know that? People get threatened, they're going to lose their jobs. Ooh. I think that's the number one challenge where God tests people. You're going to lose your job. You keep that up. Grow for it, homie. I'm going up, you're going down. That's called holy boldness. Does everybody understand? Now, there is a wisdom to all things, isn't there? You're not just going to walk in your office, your boss's office, and say, you're going to hell if you don't change your life today. Well, no, let me tell you something. God may do that. Especially if there's only like 30 seconds left. You know, you have already gone through the minute and a half, and there's only half a minute left, you know. Praise God. Again, holy boldness comes by being filled with the Holy Spirit. Acts 13. Acts 13 and verse 45. Now, are you boldness to enter God's presence? Are you willing to be bold to deny yourself? You know, the word says that the Father searches those who worship him in truth and spirit. Worships him. Worships him. Again, we always go back to worship. Because that's where boldness, you don't quit. You don't stop. You enter into, you connect. And when you connect, you want to go more anyways. Verse 45. But what? But when the Jews saw the multitudes, they were filled with envy and contradicting and blaspheming. They opposed the things spoken by Paul. Then Paul and Barnabas did what? Grew bold and said, it was necessary that the word of God should be spoken to you first. But since you reject it and judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life, behold, we turn to the Gentiles. I love it. What a powerful saying. Okay, no problem. Since you've decided to reject eternal life and would rather live in hell, No problem. But I'm your boss. No, he's my boss, not you. I may work for you. I'll submit to everything you want. But he's my boss, not you, and you're not my source. He is. You're just a resource. Hello. I'm telling you, it's time to get out there. God will honor when you stand up for him. You stand up for him, he'll stand up for you. Oh, glory. 2 Corinthians 7. Holy boldness creates what? Holy shift. And you know, when you release that in the authority and backed by the anointing of God, that seed is imparted in that person. It gives something the Holy Spirit to deal with that person. Amen? Remember, God does not desire anyone to perish. 2 Corinthians 7. Hallelujah. Is everybody okay? I'm blessed and highly favored. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 8. Let's speak it. For even if I made you sorry with my letter, I did not regret it. That's Paul's boldness. I love it. Though I did regret it, for I perceived that some epistle, for the same epistle, made you sorry, though only for what? Wow, that's what he was regretting. He said, man, I was hoping it was going to turn you completely around, but obviously it only was temporary. Now I rejoice, not that you were made sorry, but that your sorrow led to what? Repentance. For you were made sorry in a godly manner, that you might suffer loss from us in nothing. For godly sorrow produces what? Repentance, leading to salvation. Not to be regretted, but the sorrow of the world produces death. Ooh. See, some people repent because they got caught. Man, I'm really sorry. Everybody's repented when they got caught. Well, almost. But there's something. You know, think about this. Here the kingdom of God comes. He says, behold the kingdom of God. Repent, for the kingdom of God is what? At hand. You know, we hear love, 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 love. When we shouldn't hear repent, 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 repent. Because some people, when a person is not with understanding, that person thinks love, love, love covers everything. So they still do what they do. Well, God loves me. God loves me. God loves me. God loves me. I can still do this. I can still touch this. I can still say this. I can still look at this. I can still hear this. No. That's not God's love. That's deception. We are at a point in time right now where it's repent, repent, repent. Stop what you're doing and turn away and get connected. Stop it. For a worse thing come upon you. Amen? Again, we should be hearing why. Repentance leads to holiness. And in this holiness, what's happening then, that divine nature is being created more and more and more. You're becoming more like Jesus. In Luke 14. You know, one of the things that we don't want to fall into is regret. Man, if I would have just done this. I don't know if you've ever seen Schindler's List, but to me that was one of the most powerful things at the end. And that's how his cry was constantly. I could have saved more people. When I didn't, I wasted my time and my money and everything else. And I could have rescued more people. I could have put it to something else. It devastated him. Devastated him. And we don't want to get to that place. Is there something I could have done more? I feel that every day. Lord, isn't there something more I can do? How can we reach more people? How can we tell more people about you? You know? See, when I go out shopping, I always think about someone else who doesn't have. When I buy something for me, I think about somebody who doesn't have. How many children are over there starving, crying, watching their parents get murdered? Even in this own country, being abused. You know, it's terrible. Where so many people are still building their own empires. Man, we want to set up fields of grace in every country. And some of you don't know about Fields of Grace. But it's been a plan that's been imparted in us for years. And they're like facilities or safe places where people can come from the streets and live and protect it, because there'd be guards there and everything to protect them. And they would learn the ways of the Lord. But we need to have holy boldness now. In Luke 14, verse 25. Now great multitudes went with him, and he turned and said to them, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, his own life also, he cannot be my disciple." You know, many people don't want to be a disciple. They just want to be what you call a Christian. But see, Christians are disciples. If you're not willing to be a disciple, then you're really not a Christian. It's amazing to me. I'm a Christian. Yeah, I believe in Jesus. No, I don't read the word. I don't want to do I just want to be a Christian. You can't be a Christian. Unless you want to be a disciple, you can't be a Christian. You're antichrist. And don't even realize it. Oh, hallelujah. Verse 27. And whoever does not bear his cross. Now, what happens when you pull a cross out of the ground? It becomes a what? A sword. Whoever is not willing to fight, you won't follow him. Come after me cannot be my disciple. Do you fight to go after him? Do you look for him? Do you seek him? Do you ask him? Do you pray? Or do you stuff your face, go to work, and hope things work out? Hallelujah. It's amazing to me. Whoever does not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. Amen? That's simple. Hates mother, father, sister, brother. You know, we're to hate our own will, you know what I'm saying? And it doesn't mean children are to be disrespectful to their parents. Or anyone. To your elders. Amen? God places spiritual parents. Amen? He says, honor them. It's not that they're better, they're more knowledgeable. And if they're truly looking out for your life, as Christ is looking out for your life, then you would definitely respect them. Is everybody okay? See, in this fight, we pick up, it says, if you're willing to be a disciple, you're going to pick up your weapon. You're going to fight with boldness to resist the attacks of worldly desires, which have come from the enemy. If you don't, you can't follow. Those desires become idols. Everyone say every desire can become an idol if it's not from God. Is everybody all right? Are you getting this? Remember what Jesus did in the temple, right? He made a whip. Went in there and kicked over the tables. I would say that's quite boldness. Matthew 10. Oh, Oh, yes. The word says, and out of our mouth shall flow rivers of living water. Water. In other words, you will speak boldness. Because you're standing in boldness, you're anointed, you're armed, and you're dangerous. And you will speak boldness because you're standing for truth. And because you love truth. And you want to see others be rescued. Matthew chapter 10 and verse 32. Hallelujah. Matthew 10, 32. It's just for you. Holy boldness. Let's speak it together. Therefore, who? What? Whoever confesses me before men, him I will also confess before my Father who is in heaven. That's going to take some boldness, isn't it? Yeah. Verse 33, but whoever denies me before men, him I will also deny before my Father who is in heaven. Do not think I came to what? Bring peace on earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a what? A sword. Well, you don't use a sword without boldness. I'm going to tell you that right now. Amen. For I've come to set a man against his father, a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And an enemy's and a man's enemies will be those of his own household. Hallelujah. For he who loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And he who loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And those who does not take his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me. He who finds his life will lose it. And he who loses his life for my name's sake will what? Find a life. And Matthew 11, while we're here, in verse 11. Let's speak it. Assuredly, I say to you, among those born of women, there has not been, not risen one greater than John the Baptist. Was John bold? Oh, man, was he bold. Come on. He didn't give a hoot. Even the way he dressed, he had his own style. You know, he didn't dress like everybody else. He started his whole lewd thing, man. And even his diet was different than everyone else, right? So the dude was totally different in everything. But he was bold. Number one, bold. Filled with the Holy Spirit. Didn't care what anybody thought. Rebuked all the religious dudes. Vipers, he called them. Who warned you of your wrath that's coming? He warned them. What do you mean? These guys are coming out to see what's going on. What do you mean? I'm a Sanhindi. I know the word of God. Now you're a religious flesh creature. You think you know, but you don't know. Jesus even warned them, said, you search the scriptures thinking you have salvation, but you won't come to me to get it. You won't come to me to get it. Why? You're not willing to connect with me to maintain. Does everybody get that? Oh, glory. Surely I say to among those born of women, there's not been one greater than John the Baptist. But he who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. And from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of God of the heavens, what suffers? Suffers what? Violence. Why? There's constant battle. And the violent take it by what? I'd say that's boldness. Boldness. Take it by force. Grab the throat of the devil. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John. And if you are willing to receive it, he is Elijah who is to come. He who has ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit of the Lord says. 2 Peter chapter 3. You know, some of these congressmen and senators would stand up and be bold for what the truth is, but they're afraid of losing their jobs. If some of these pastors would stand up to decree what the boldness is, but they're afraid of losing a congregation or their money to support what they have. Listen, you and I came in with nothing. We're leaving with nothing. But one thing we want to leave with is souls. Amen. Oh, hallelujah. 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 14, please. Therefore, beloved, looking forward to things, to these things, be what? Diligent to be found by him in peace without spot and blameless. And consider that the long-suffering of our Lord is salvation, is also our brother, beloved brother Paul, according to the wisdom given to him, has written to you. Also, in all his epistles, speaking in them of these things, in which are some things hard to what? Understand, but they can be interpreted by the Holy Spirit. Does everybody get it? See, God requires me and you to be connected to his Spirit. Which untaught and unstable people twist to their own destruction, as they also do all the rest of the scriptures. There's many unstable, double-mindedness. Some people, there's the double-mindedness is created by two people. There's like two people in one. They play the game at night, and they play the game during the day. Amen? Does everybody get it? There are those who do things at night, in darkness, behind closed doors, and then they do things out in front during the day. They're sweet during the day, and they become wicked at night. And call themselves Christians. But God knows. Those are double-minded, unstable. Amen. Is everybody okay? You therefore, beloved, since you know this beforehand, beware lest you what? Lest you also fall from your own steadfastness, being led away with the error of the wicked. Let me tell you something. When somebody says, I'm standing, that's one step away to a fall. If you're just standing, you're one step away from the fall. You need to be more than just standing. You need to get off of standing and step in. But it says here, but grow in the grace, grow in the plan, and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and to him be glory, both now and forever. Amen. 2 Peter chapter 1, while we're here. Oh, yes. 2 Peter chapter 1. I want to start at verse 1, or verse 2. Everybody okay? But grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of our Lord Jesus, as his divine power, everyone say divine power, has given to us all things to pertain to life and godliness, to the knowledge of him who called us by the glory and virtue. So you have the power to choose, you know. It's divine power. By which have been given to us exceedingly and great and precious promises, that through these you may be partakers. Everyone say partaker of the divine nature. So that means you have a choice. If you're not partaking, amen? If you're not partaking, if you're not being connected, the divine nature cannot be manifested. It can't be. For you're still, you've got one foot in the world and one foot in the kingdom. The divine nature does not have, it cannot be manifested. It can't be expressed. Does everybody get it? The word says bad company corrupts good habits, right? If you serve two masters, you're going to end up serving the enemy. You cannot serve God serving two masters. So this is where you and I have to have boldness. We have to, with the power has been given to me and you to say no to temptation, no to evil, no. Why? So that the divine nature can be manifested. See, so it's your responsibility and my responsibility to keep the manifestation of the divine nature going. And that's to maintain connection. Now, when you have divine nature, you're a partaker of the divine nature. Divine power increases. Divine wisdom. Divine favor. All kinds of things. Boldness will increase. Hallelujah. Verse 4, by which have been given to us exceedingly and great precious promises, that through these you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through what?
Lust.
In other words, you're going to overcome temptation. But also for this very reason, given all diligence, add to your faith virtue to virtue, knowledge to knowledge, self-control to self-control, perseverance to perseverance, godliness to godliness, brotherly kindness, and brotherly kindness, love. For these things are yours and abound. You will what? You will neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. For he who lacks these things is short-sighted and even to blindness is forgotten that he was cleansed from his old sins. Therefore, brethren, be even more diligent to make your call and election sure. If you do these things, you will never stumble. For so an entrance will be supplied to you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Partakers, true partakers of the divine nature, walk in authority and boldness. I want to share something very important, because everyone wants to earn God's trust. I want to tell you how you do that. When you see what he sees, you earn his trust. Has everybody got it? If you do not see what he sees, you can't earn his trust. That's bottom line. So he's training me and you so that you, look at, when he spoke to the prophets, he said, what do you see? What do you see? You must see what he sees. You must see evil. You must see influence. You must see what's clean and unclean. You must see what's holy and unholy. You must see what pleases him and displeases him. You must see these things. If you do not see what he sees, he cannot trust you. That's why everything is associated with training. All your trials and tribulations, everything you're going, he says, count it all joy. Why? He wants to get you to a place where you see what he sees. When that happens, you begin to earn his trust. Other than that, you're going to bust your butt in survival instead of surrender. Does everybody understand this? Vitally important. I'm telling you, this is one of the nuggets that the Lord gave to me the other day. Because I always, you know, Lord, show me, what do you want me to do to please you? How do we earn your trust? Can you trust someone that trusts you? Yes. Can you trust someone that doesn't trust you? Well, how do you think he is? And I was asking him, Lord, what? And he said, look it. When you see what I see, I trust you. I thought, wow. When you see what I see, I trust you. If you don't see what I see, I can't trust you. Doesn't mean I don't love you. But I can't trust you. Now, I may trust you in some things because you see what I see. But in other things, you don't see what I see. Amen? Is everybody okay? Amen. Psalm 15. And we'll close here. Holy boldness. So you're going to have, in other words, if you're seeing what God's seeing, you're going to have holy boldness in that circumstance and situation. Amen. And you know what's going to happen? You're going to fulfill what he asked you to do, and a promise is released. You know, think about when Paul was attacked and so forth. What did he say? Look at man, I know you have your traditions and your ways, but you know what? We're accountable to God. We're going to speak what we need to speak because it pleases God, not because it pleases you. These guys were thrown in prison, whipped, all kinds of stuff because they spoke boldness of the things of God. There's too many wimps in the kingdom. We need to speak boldness. It's time. 2-minute warning is going. Amen? Verse 15, Psalm 15, verse 1. Let's speak it. Lord, who may abide in your tabernacle? Who may dwell in your holy hill? He who walks uprightly and works righteousness and speaks the truth in his heart. He who does not backbite with his tongue, nor does evil to his neighbor, nor does he take up a reproach against his friend, in whose eyes a vile person is despised. But he honors those who fear the Lord. He who swears to his own hurt and does not change, he who does not put out his money at usury, nor does he take a bribe against the innocent. He who does these things shall never be moved. Oh, glory. You won't be moved. You won't be misled. You will stand steadfast with boldness. You will stand in the presence of God. You will be backed by heaven. Doesn't mean you won't make a mistake. And believe me, you will offend people. Too bad. Think about how many people were offended. Listen, when people are out there using and whatever, you know, you get somebody comes up and you says, yo, man, can I have $20? All right. No. Boy, did they get offended.
Amen.
Well, you knew they were going to use it for wrong, right?
Amen.
So don't feed a demon. Starve it. Rebuke the person that's carrying it. Tell them. You live this way, you continue to live this way, you know where you're going. And it ain't Hotel California. And no matter how many squirt guns you carry with you, it ain't going to work. So it's time to stay bold. Amen? Time. It's time to get bolder. It's time to infiltrate. It's time to kick down doors. No, I don't mean your neighbor's doors, all right? Don't go. or your roommates or whatever. Please keep the doors. I meant spiritual doors, amen? It's time to kick down spiritual doors that the enemy's holding up. Well, the Bible says, bind a strong man that you can enter and plunder the goods of the evil one, right? Praise God. It's time to stand in boldness. Why? Because we stand before God every day, every decision. And everything we do. Let's bring honor to his name. Let's please him. And let's live a life that brings all glory and praise to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, expressing his divine nature that others may see him in you. In Jesus' name. And everybody said amen.